morning, everybody. We're a few minutes behind schedule, but that's to be expected on opening day. So I'm Colin Ross, and before I get introduced and before I speak, I want to introduce the conference. So this is a conference on investment strategies in a down economy. Are you everybody in the right place? So this is the second time I've spoken at the second annual conference. And it was a most enjoyable and positive experience last year, and I expect the same this year. The first multiple personality conference I went to would be 1984, and that was the ISS MPND it was back then. And it peaked about probably late 80s, early 90s. The attendance peaked around 800 people. And then we got into the false memory wars in the 90s, which you'll hear about. And the attendance dropped down to 250 probably at the lowest. And it's been oscillating in the between 250 and 350 for 10 or 15 years now. And that's an organization that has a journal, has a board, it has a management company, has advertising budget. And this conference has half the attendance, basically, of the annual ISSTD conference, which shows you in this economy, this market, this culture, that's a hard thing to do. That's very amazing, very impressive achievement. And for some grassroots people to just go, okay, I think we'll do a conference, and then actually have it happen, be well organized, well attended, well exhibited at, a most amazing and helpful and useful contribution to the field. And all the credit goes to one human being plus her delegates, which is Pat. So, you'd be very hard-pressed to find a survivor, recovered person who's contributed individually more to the field. She certainly would be in the top five minimum. So congratulations and thank you for your efforts.
The President of Ivory Garden, and I welcome you all to bright, sunny Washington, Seattle. It's going to be sunny all weekend. The pool, I believe, is open tomorrow. That's important. Ivory Garden is a 501c3 charitable organization. We started in 2007 as a support online group, and last year our members really wanted to have a conference, so we did, and we made it happen. And I'd like to first, if you guys go through your schedules, introduce the board of directors: Beverly Martin, Susan Ratner, Karen Colasa, Laura Denton, Catherine Woods, and Amy Soto. I don't know how many of them are here, but if you could stand up. Crathen, Catherine. I believe they're all outside trying to put name tags together and get set up. So everybody's here, though. And if you look in your book, you'll recognize. Okay, so I'm going through this book one by one. I'd like to thank our sponsors, Colin Ross Institute, the Ross Institute for Trauma at UBH in Denton, which is United Behavioral Health, and they're right here. A.V. Shaw is over there doing A.V. The SI organization, which stands for Survivors of Institutional Abuse, Jody Hobbs. And she has a table out there. Trauma Disorders Program, Shepherd Pratt, beautiful table out there. Go by the tables and look. 3D Enterprises is Stephen Kimborough back there behind that screen. And then EMDR Solution, which is Robin Shapiro, and she'll be speaking.
Colin Ross, everybody.
Well, thank you for the lengthy introduction. So I might go like a little bit over, but not much. So we'll be a little bit compressed here, but I've got plenty of time. By the end, you'll be going, oh no, not one more example of how monstrously unintelligent and bad attitude based these extreme skeptics are, because there's a lot of examples. So I'm a skeptic, I believe. I think reasonable skepticism is absolutely the way to go in life in general, politics, except for presidential candidate debates. Should just believe everything they say. It's the hallmark of science. Nobody in science goes, skepticism is bad. So I'm not talking about reasonable skepticism, you know, scholarly based skepticism, accurate analysis, weighing arguments. I'm talking about way out there, rigid, ideological, hostile, unprofessional, unethical, unscholarly, that's the best I can say about it, kind of performance by these extreme skeptics. So if we had reasonable skepticism, I think I've published more reasonable skepticism about DID than the extreme skeptics ever have. This is my contact information, which is also available in my books, and you can get it from us at the display. These are two books. If you were thinking of buying one of my books, forget the dissociative identity one because it's not here, and it's outrageously expensive. The trauma model therapy is practical, hands-on case examples, how to do the treatment within this model with therapist, client, dialogues as examples. So launching into the extreme skeptics. In 1992, I was at the Canadian Psychiatric Association meeting in Montreal debating, is multiple personality real and valid or not? And there was two of us on the yes it is side and two of it on the no it isn't side. And Francois Mai and Harold Mirsky were the two opponents. Francois Mai, who's a Canadian psychiatrist who doesn't publish on trauma or dissociation at all, he went through a series of arguments. And one of his arguments was, when you look at surveys, large surveys of the general population, they don't find any cases of multiple personality disorder. And he would talk a little bit and then he would make this resounding statement. And the number of cases of multiple personality, none. You talk a little bit more. And the number of cases of multiple personality, zero. So what was my rebuttal? So this is the peak of the profession, the national conference, people selected as having a special interest in this topic. My response to him was, yeah, but Francois, in these surveys, the surveyors didn't ask any questions about dissociative symptoms or trauma. So this is like the level of debate that goes on. It's literally, you would not get into the high school debating club with this level of academic performance. And so I realized that this is not really about any kind of high quality logic, scholarship, or professional critique. So this is only the first slide here. There's a lot of examples. So arguments are applied to DID that could just as well be used against all other psychiatric disorders. So, and many of the specific arguments fall into this category. So for example, could you stand up at a medical conference and say, there's more cases per 100,000 people of AIDS in Africa than there are in Idaho. Therefore, AIDS is not really a real disease, it's just a hysterical fad in Africa. Like, nobody in 100,000 years is ever gonna say that at a medical conference, because it's obviously preposterous, obviously ridiculous. But this is one of the standard arguments about DID not being valid, that there's more cases diagnosed inside the United States than there are in the rest of the world. And all of these arguments have been made for 25 years in the literature now. They don't change. They're not modulated. It's just the same old, same old, same old, same old. So I've been hearing this for literally over a quarter of a century. So what's the counter argument to this? Besides the AIDS example, this piece of information, which was very true back in the 80s and 90s, still pretty true, but not quite as true, because there's cases being diagnosed around the world, but still there's way more cases diagnosed in the United States and Canada than elsewhere. This fact, which is a fact, so you can't really debate the fact, is completely neutral regarding whether DID is valid or not valid, real or not real. Because there's, in science, so this is literally elementary school. In elementary school, I was taught about scientific method. You make an observation, that's the fact. So here the observation is more cases of in North America than outside North America. Then what you do is you create a hypothesis. Here's what I think is going on. Then you do an experiment to test your hypothesis, see if your theory accounts for this fact. So the fact is just a fact. It's how to understand it, how to explain it. And then you have the results, and then you have discussion and so on. This is how scientists do things. A scientist doesn't take the fact and then use the fact to prove their theory about the fact. That doesn't make any sense. Never, ever, ever, ever does that happen in science. But it happens in this debate. Okay, so the fact is there's more cases diagnosed in North America. That proves that it's a fad that takes place in North America. But we've just gone from the fact to the theory, and then we've proven the theory's correct because we go back to the fact. It's just not science, which I learned literally in elementary school is not the way science operates. So if we go to the fact, we can have two competing hypotheses. One explanation is it's a bunch of hysterical patients and a bunch of hysterical psychiatrists and therapists, and they're just diagnosing this phantom thing out of nowhere. And elsewhere in the world, people are more sensible, aren't contaminated with this hysteria, so therefore they don't diagnose it, and it's actually very, very rare or non-existent. That's hypothesis number one. Hypothesis number two is people in North America have gotten themselves educated about how to recognize it and diagnose it. People outside North America haven't. That's why there's more cases diagnosed inside North America than out. So it's two competing hypotheses. Both are equally consistent with the basic fact. And you can't tell which one is right by just going, yeah, but there's more cases diagnosed in North America. You got to do some sort of experiment or research or study. But the skeptics don't do any research or study. They just keep saying, it's a fact, therefore I'm right and you're wrong. So that's not science. I could give you a whole bunch of examples of, for instance, the bar for publishing a paper on schizophrenia is set here. So if you want to publish a paper in a psychiatry journal arguing that schizophrenia is a genetic biological brain disease, and you do a little bit of research and throw some data on there, you get published easily. If you want to go to the same journal and present an argument that DID is a valid and reliable diagnosis, the amount of evidence you require is set way up here. So the literature and the journals require way, 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 way more evidence. And the bar may be set so high that in many journals you can't get anything published about multiple personality, DID, no matter what. So the bar is not set the same for different disorders. And if you mount an argument that schizophrenia is actually just hysteria, it's not a real illness, there's no chance you'll get published. Whereas if you mount an argument that DID is hysteria, not a real illness, you've got very good odds of getting published. So there's different standards. It's a double standard all across the board in many different ways. DID is not valid because its treatment has not been proven effective. Okay, good, so we just proved that Alzheimer's not a real disease because we don't have an effective treatment for it. We've just proven that cancer of the pancreas is not a real disease because we don't have an effective treatment for it. So again, nobody in medicine could make these kind of statements. If you did make that statement, somebody might come and say, we need to take you for an examination to see if you're able to keep your license. So if it is true that there is no valid treatment, no effective treatment, that tells you nothing about whether it's actually a valid disease or disorder or not. Nothing at all. Because there's many, many perfectly valid real diseases that we don't have good treatments for now. Go back in time 150 years, we didn't have any good treatments for almost all of them. That didn't mean they weren't real. So saying, even if it was true that we had no properly designed treatment outcome literature for DID, even if that was true, it would prove nothing about whether DID is valid. You can't use that argument in actual science. And then the second problem is we do have some outcome literature. DID is not a disease because it is influenced by culture. Okay, here we are at the American Psychiatric Association annual meeting, and I stand up and I go, schizophrenia is not a real disease because it's influenced by culture. what's the response I'm going to get? I'm going to, first of all, get booed or condescended to or joked about. But I'm going to get told that that's not true. That schizophrenia is a biological genetic brain disease and it's consistent around the world. But then I'm going to get told that, well, the symptoms do vary depending on which country you're in. For instance, people in the jungles of Africa generally don't have delusions that they're pursued by the CIA because they've never heard of the CIA. But then the explanation will be, well, that's just kind of the content. Okay, so it's just the content. The actual structure of the disease is the same everywhere, just like arthritis of the hip is basically the same everywhere because it's truly a disease. Oh, okay. In that case, why does the World Health Organization state, based on lots and lots of evidence, that the outcome for schizophrenia is better in the third world than it is in industrialized countries where there's medicine and antipsychotic medications? If it's the same disease, why would people do better in third world countries than in first world countries? It doesn't make any sense. I was also taught that in the 19th century, and we saw these photographs, there's all these people with catatonia, like standing like this for days and days and days and days and days. I've never seen one of these people. I don't know anybody who's seen one of these people. Where did all those genetic brain disease catatonia cases go? So the facts that we know about schizophrenia don't even fit with it's not influenced by culture. But what gets set up is these two completely distinct categories. Biological brain disease uninfluenced by culture at all. Completely invalid disease that's totally an artifact of hysteria and culture. It's 100%. So it's either 100% influenced by culture or 0%. There's nothing that human beings do, think, say, see, perceive, or believe in that is not influenced by culture. It's an impossible, preposterous thing to state. So this is the biological genetic brain disease model trying to destroy something that doesn't fit with the biological genetic brain disease model by saying that's influenced by culture. Failing to recognize that everything's influenced by culture, that the manifestations of many different DSM disorders vary tremendously by culture, including depression, substance abuse, all kinds of different things. So it's a completely bogus argument, and you would flunk an undergraduate anthropology course if you handed in essays saying things like this. All anthropologists know that this is ridiculous and preposterous, which proves that psychiatrists are not anthropologists. The absence of cases outside North America, so I did that one. The increase in diagnosis of DID in the 1980s is evidence of its artifactual nature. DID was rarely diagnosed in the 19th century. So this is just a variation on the inside-outside North America argument. So not only is it diagnosed more in North America, it's diagnosed more since 1980 than it was before, which proves it's hysteria. But again, that's taking the fact, creating a hypothesis to explain the fact, and then proving that your hypothesis is true by restating the fact. So it's simply a fact. There's more cases diagnosed now than there was in the 19th century. What does that prove? A bunch of crazy therapists and psychiatrists? Or we've gotten more aware of this, we now know how to detect it, and we've just gotten up to speed on it. Both those theories are equally consistent with the facts. The facts don't prove or disprove either the theory. Skeptics make appeals to authority. So an appeal to authority, this is again, literally undergraduate philosophy course. You got to understand this stuff to pass an undergraduate philosophy course. An appeal to authority is, well, if the authority is Colin Ross, that's an exception, it's okay then. Or Steve Frankel. Appeal to authority is, it's true because Freud said it. So it's just, or it's true because Karl Marx said it, or Ronald Reagan said it. Donald Trump said it, we're not so sure about that. But so that's, it's, you appeal to the authority of the person who's just speaking from on high the revealed truth. You don't have to prove it or disprove it, and you completely slam your opponent because Mr. Big said it's true. So this group of extreme skeptics who are the authorities that they appeal to? They're friends and co-authors. So there's a group of, like, in terms of publishing, under 10 of these guys in the last 25 years, and they'll make a point, and then they'll cite their friends as the authorities that prove that they're right. Well, the Aryan Brotherhood does that too, but I don't think it's science. Validity can be inferred from anecdotal short-term treatment outcome. Okay, what does that mean? So in science, totally accepted, not debated, there's evidence-based treatments. And there's levels of evidence. And these are all defined and they're in the literature. So there's, like, the top level of evidence is a randomized controlled trial, which the drug companies have lots of money, so they're able to fund these kind of studies, where you come into the study, just randomly, you're assigned either the real drug or the placebo, then you're followed forward in time. You don't know if you're on real drug or placebo, the doctor doesn't know, that's why it's double blind. It's prospective because it's going forward in time. And then you see, do the people on the drug do better than the people on placebo? That's the highest level of evidence. That's level one. Then there's level two, level three. These are all levels of evidence. The lowest level of evidence is the single case. So that makes sense and is true, but not true. So the doctor's in the ER, and in comes the guy who's been shot in the chest multiple times, and he's dead. Does the doctor go, we can't be sure in this case what the causality is because we only have an anecdotal case report? No. So one case of guy dying from a gunshot wound, it's obvious, you know why the guy died. So you can reach a very firm conclusion from an individual case. But to make a statement like DID isn't valid, and one reason it's not valid is there's no evidence. Well, you need evidence that there's no evidence, right? So you'd have to do a study showing we took 100 or 200 people with DID, we randomly assigned them to DID therapy or doing nothing, and the people who got the DID therapy did worse, and the people where we did nothing kind of grumbled along. And if we gave them an antidepressant, they did even better. So that would be the top level of evidence. So all that the skeptics have is themselves saying that individual cases do badly. And as far as I know, there's only one paper published by Harold Mirsky, who's one of the guys I debated in 1992, where he had four cases that he presented. Each case was like this much in the journal. And they were so vaguely described and so poorly followed up and so poorly diagnosed that you couldn't conclude anything about anything from them. You couldn't even tell that they actually had DID. But he's saying that these are iatrogenic, fake, created cases of DID, and they did way better when he got hold of them, undiagnosed the DID, and gave them some other treatment. But you can't even tell, like, what their symptoms were, how they were functioning. There's no information there. And that's it in terms of levels of evidence. But then the skeptics will say that they know for a fact that the treatment of DID is harmful based on what? They don't have any evidence. And then they will criticize the DID field for not having any evidence when we in fact have lots of evidence at a much higher level than that. This is how, like, crazy and mixed up the whole thing is. Bad therapeutic practices call the validity of DID into question. Okay. So did you know that there's some clinics in Mexico that have got completely bogus treatments for cancer that do nothing and they're ripping people off for thousands of dollars? Proving that cancer is not a real disorder. Come on, guys. So even if it was true that there's crazy therapies for DID that are harmful that some therapists are doing, that tells you nothing about whether DID is valid or not. Just tells you there's some bad therapy. So none of this makes any scientific sense whatsoever. Okay, now you're going to start getting exhausted. Diagnostic criteria for DID are vague, therefore DID is not valid. These are all arguments that have been published in psychiatry journals. Okay, well, what is it that's so vague about the criteria for DID? You've got different identities, personality states that have different names and ages, and they're switching. So adult Susan's talking, now little Mary's talking. Completely different behavior, different memories, different attitudes, different everything, tone of voice. Then little person goes back inside and the adult doesn't even remember the conversation. Boy, that's vague. Boy, you sure see all kinds of people doing that all the time, right? What's so vague about that? Okay, maybe the idea is vague. I don't get it. What's vague about that? People with bipolar disorder, like, don't do that. People who are just depressed don't all of a sudden go, I'm happy now, I think I'll go out and ride my motorcycle. It just doesn't happen, these sudden switches of behavioral state that have names and ages attached to them, have amnesia barriers, and are tied back into childhood trauma. It just doesn't happen. Well, maybe it's just DID therapists who know how to tell the difference because they see it everywhere. So how do you find out if a diagnosis is incredibly vague and nobody can agree who has it and who doesn't have it? There's a completely established procedure for doing that called reliability studies, and the rules for that and the evidence and the type of statistics completely accepted in the literature and have been used for depression and schizophrenia and substance abuse and bulimia. And we take exactly the same methodology, we apply it to DID, and we find out that the agreement rate on who has DID and who doesn't is equal to or superior to the average for other DSM disorders. We've proven that in the literature. So the whole argument has nothing to do with the actual facts and evidence that have been published. That just gets ignored. And people say it's vague. Okay, let me give you an example of a non-vague diagnosis. This person has been blue, depressed, sad, down in the dumps most of the time for the last 2 weeks. That's the first criterion for depression. Most of the time. Okay, what's the scientific definition of most of the time? There isn't one. Does most of the time mean 75% or 90 or 60? Or there's no numbers. There's no actual measurable criterion there. It's just most of the time. So that's extremely vague. That's the criteria for depression, which is a core accepted psychiatric diagnosis. Okay, so you have to be blue, depressed, down in the dumps, but how blue, depressed, and down in the dumps? A bunch. A bunch is, that's really literally what's in the criteria. It's a judgment call, how severe it has to be. There's actually depression measures that are used in research, but clinicians never use them. Clinicians just go, this person's been really depressed most of the time for 2 weeks. So you'd think depression's well studied, well accepted in psychiatry. There's billions of dollars of antidepressant sales in every year. You'd think that psychiatrists could agree on this non-vague diagnosis that's completely accepted by mainstream psychiatry. So in the DSM-5 field trials for depression, they actually did studies where there's a large number of people, a bunch of different psychiatrists look at basically videotapes of them being interviewed, and all these psychiatrists decide this person's depressed, this person's not depressed. And then they look at what's the agreement level between the psychiatrists using a statistic called Cohen's Kappa. If Cohen's Kappa is 1, it's perfect agreement every single time. This guy's depressed, this guy isn't. If it's 0, it's totally random. The threshold for a pretty reasonable Cohen's Kappa for a psychiatric diagnosis, you want to definitely be above 0.5. Really good to be above 0.6. If you get to 0.7, which is now we're getting up to the range for DID, you're pretty solid. In the DSM-5 field trials, the Cohen's Kappa for depression was 0.37. But nobody attacks depression because it's vague. They just attack DID because it's vague, but it's not even vague just as a literary sketch. And the data show that the agreement for DID is double the agreement for depression. But that doesn't stop the skeptics from saying DID is not valid because it's vague. Unproven etiology invalidates DID. Etiology means the cause. Okay, so DID is not a valid disorder because we don't know the cause. Again, if that was true, what would that prove? What's the cause of cancer of the pancreas? Nobody on this planet knows. The cause of schizophrenia, people think they know, but if you read the DSM-5, it says that basically the cause of all of these disorders is not known, all across the board. We don't have a locked down, proven, scientifically demonstrated cause or blood test or brain scan for any DSM disorder. It's equally true that we haven't proven the cause of all these other disorders, but you can't stand up and say, schizophrenia doesn't have a proven cause, therefore it's not a real disorder. Nobody will listen to you. But when you say that about DID, you get published and, oh yeah, nice argument. And in fact, we have lots of evidence about the traumatic origins of DID. And anyway, how obvious is it to anybody who works with people with DID? Lack of proven physiological differences between alters invalidates DID. So DID is not real because you haven't demonstrated that different alters are different biologically. Nobody to this day has ever measured any biological difference between a person in a manic state and a person in a depressed state. You can't go to the literature and find it. There's no diagnostic test for this person's manic, this person's depressed. This is equally true of all the DSM disorders, except for a few like you're drunk, okay, your blood alcohol is above 0.8. But not counting those, there's no test that could tell you this person's normal now, or they're manic, or they're psychotic, or they're whatever it might be. Have I ever seen a case of DID without a history of trauma? Yes and no, kind of, but not really. So I've certainly seen, that's kind of vague, yeah, good one. So I have slides, but I don't have them with me. There's 5 large case series of DID. And when you average it up all together, it's 88 to 95% of people with DID that's diagnosed describe physical abuse or sexual abuse or both. Meaning that 5 to 12% don't. So do they have trauma? Well, obviously there's several answers to this question. One answer is I don't know for sure. Another answer is, well, yeah, they have trauma, but they just don't want to talk about it right now. Another answer is they have trauma, but they genuinely don't remember. And so then there could be a little group that doesn't have physical or sexual abuse, but physical and sexual abuse are only 2 types of trauma. So when you don't have physical or sexual abuse, there's usually big family violence, death of parents, chaos, medical surgical things going on. So I've never clinically met a case of DID where everything was fine throughout life. It just doesn't happen. Milder trauma and milder cases where you only have maybe 2-3 parts and they don't have names. It's like me and angry me and sad me. And they're switching and there's sort of amnesia, but not totally. So then the question is that DID or DDNOS, or which is now called OSDD in DSM-5. But you can have a complex chronic dissociative disorder that's relatively simple, relatively doesn't interfere with your life, relatively easy to treat, with quite mildish trauma. But somebody who's completely normal, no trauma, no misery, no chaos, no violence, no nothing, and they've got complex DID, you just never see it. Ever, ever. Let's see now. Okay, validity of DID can be disproven by accumulating examples of false positive diagnoses. So that's false positive means you diagnose DID, but you're wrong, they don't really have DID. Okay, so this is another example of using an argument that equally applies to all other psychiatric diagnoses. You're absolutely prohibited from using it against other diagnoses, but you're open season to use it against DID. So you can't go to a psychiatry meeting and say, excuse me, sir, nice talk on schizophrenia, but I've diagnosed several cases of bipolar disorder that had previous mistaken diagnoses of schizophrenia. Therefore, schizophrenia doesn't exist. Again, you just get laughed out of there. And clinicians all over the place have experience with, they previously had a diagnosis of schizophrenia and now they're being treated for bipolar. They previously had a schizoaffective disorder, now they've got schizophrenia. These disorders slip slide around back and forth. According to the DSM-5, this is officially stated in DSM-5, that these disorders slip slide around all the time. So even if you did find 2, 5, 20, 100 cases of DID that were mistakenly diagnosed, this would tell us nothing about the validity of DID. It would just tell us some diagnosticians made some mistakes. That's it. Okay, now this one's a little bit more of a time burner. If repression is not proven, DID is not real. Again, this is stated by the skeptics in the literature. So when you open the DSM, you can see the psychosis section, the mood disorder section, and then you go to the repression section, right? And there's repression disorders. No, there is no repression section in the DSM-5. The word repression isn't even in the DSM-5. There's no repression disorders. So what's this repression's not real, therefore DID is not real? Well, DID is based on dissociation, not repression. Nobody in the DID field talks about DID being based on repression. And Freud had repression-based theories for all the different diagnoses. So there's repression theories of all kinds of different diagnoses. Repression and dissociation are not the same thing. But the skeptics sort of go and make repression and dissociation be the same thing, which is completely incorrect scientifically and scholarly, history of psychiatry-wise. And it'll take more minutes to go into that in detail. So it's a false equation, repression equals dissociation. The repression is not real, therefore DID is not real. That's just, so I was born in Canada, so all Canadians are not real, because Canadians are all ghosts. Well, if it was true that all Canadians are ghosts, then you could say they're not real, they don't have physical bodies. But what if all Canadians aren't ghosts, they do have physical bodies? It's exactly the same sort of level of logic. The diagnosis of DID encourages irresponsible behavior. How many hundreds of times have I heard this? It doesn't have to. That's a, if we're going to call this politics, that's a political position. Okay, so I didn't make it into the Republican presidential debates this year, but if I was up there, I would go, having cancer gives you a license to rob banks. You don't even have to have cancer diagnosed by a psychiatrist. You can just claim that you have cancer, and then you should never be put in jail for robbing banks. Probably not going to get the nomination. But if that was true, how many criminals would start claiming they have cancer? And then we would say, oh, you've got cancer, you can't help it, we'll let you off. But you don't have to do that. You could just as well go, we don't care if you got cancer, it doesn't give you a license to rob banks, and you're going to get the same consequences as anybody else. So that could be true of cancer, headaches, your race, your gender, anything about a person, including whether they do or don't have DID. The diagnosis of DID does not automatically lead to the person can't help it, they can get away with all kinds of stuff, and they get no consequences. It could, if you set your things up that way, if that was your rule of therapy, you could operate that way, but you don't have to. And in my treatment model, I hold people responsible as human beings, as whole people. So this idea that DID automatically gives a license for irresponsible behavior, totally bogus, not true, isn't in the literature. It's not the way successful people, successful therapists who are able to help people walk through to recovery operate. So it's a completely bogus argument. Multiples are really just borderlines. Okay, again, heard it hundreds and hundreds of times. It's in the literature. Well, this is a useful argument because what are borderlines? Borderlines are a bunch of hysterical, pain in the neck women who run around causing trouble for psychiatrists who are trying to get some serious work done. That's the picture of borderlines that's in the literature that the people who say they're really just borderlines mean. They don't mean, oh, these people have a very legitimate problem, we've just mistaken it for DID. What they mean is, this is not a legitimate disorder, it's a bunch of hysterical women running around, and now they're getting encouraged by these hysterical therapists, and they've got DID, they're really just borderlines. So we're just switching the category of trash talk. Well, so what is borderline personality anyway? Well, there's lots and lots and lots and lots of evidence that I'll talk about tomorrow that borderline personality disorder is itself a trauma disorder, basically. You never meet an inpatient with borderline personality disorder who came from anything but a hugely traumatic background, ever. So even if they really were just borderlines, they're still in the category of severe chronic trauma disorder. But what are the facts? And these are facts that have been in the literature for 25 years, which is partially my fault because I published some of those studies. If you take 100 people with MPD, DID, it'll bounce around from study to study, but ballparkish, about 60% will meet criteria for borderline personality disorder. So we could get rid of those guys because they're really just borderlines. Well, what about the other 40% who don't meet criteria for borderline personality disorder? They can't really be borderlines because they don't meet the criteria. So it doesn't account for the whole disorder. We've got lots of evidence showing that that's the case. We also have evidence that if you take 100 people with borderline personality disorder, around about two-thirds have a diagnosable dissociative disorder. So these are not just neat little separate categories. They're overlapping parts of the whole trauma mess. DID is an artifact of suggestibility in highly hypnotizable patients or individuals. That's one of the core platforms of the, it's not a real diagnosis, it's just a bunch of people who say, did you get the Martians out of your house yet, or are they still bothering your family? And then she goes, oh my God, the Martians, what is such a problem, my family? As if you just like make a little comment to somebody and they totally buy it, believe it, and they just go off the deep end with it. Well, they don't say it's quite that easy. It may take 2 or 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, maybe even 10 therapy sessions. But these people with DID are just malleable clay. They don't know their own minds. They don't know their own reality. And you can just go, oh, why don't you go off down this little path of tulips? And they'll just go running down there because they want to please you. That's the picture of people with DID. It's incredibly chauvinistic, demeaning, belittling, and it's not even scientifically true. People with DID as a group are in fact highly hypnotizable. But there's no real scientific evidence to support this idea that it's just a bunch of suggestible, hypnotizable people who didn't have the DID before. So the people who say that haven't proven their case with any kind of research. And we've got lots and lots and lots and lots of research showing that these people had tons of complicated symptoms before they ever met the clinician who decided they have DID. So part of the picture is going along, no amnesia spells, no voices talking in your head, no trauma history. Hello, nice to meet you. Oh, by the way, I have voices in my head, trauma history, and I can't remember things that happened. That's the picture. That none of this existed before the suggestible therapist and the suggestible patient got together, which you'll see in an upcoming slide is not true. It's impossible to have more than one personality in the same body, therefore, DID is not real. Brilliant, nice one. This is part of the reason why we changed the name from multiple personality to DID, because we're so tired of hearing it's not possible to have more than one personality. Well, hello, of course it's not. And the way I explain this to patients, which I've done within the last week, is, okay, here's the central paradox of DID. It's real and it's not real. Both things are true. It's not literally concretely real. So if we took an x-ray of your head, we wouldn't see all these little skeletons in there. And if there was a bunch of little people this big with bony skeletons running around inside your brain would be destroyed. And nobody goes, oh yeah, there are. because it's kind of a cute little image, oh, those little skeletons in my brain. So everybody agrees that that's true. It's not threatening, it's not invalidating, it's just a fact. On the other hand, it's completely psychologically true that people come to and they're somewhere else, they don't know how they got there, people are calling them by a different name, they open their closet, there's different clothes. These are real psychological experiences that people actually have, for sure. It's just not literally, concretely possible to have 20 human beings all crammed in one body. So people like me who believe in DID aren't even saying that there's more than one personality. There's one person who's fragmented into these identity states, which are very psychologically real. So it's a complete bogus argument, which is very hard to understand. Why would completely non-bogus people make completely non-bogus arguments? A few clinicians are making all the diagnoses. Okay, so we've just proven that cystic fibrosis is not a real disease because all the cystic fibrosis people seem to be at the cystic fibrosis clinics getting diagnosed by the specialist in cystic fibrosis, and the average family physician is not hardly seeing any. Therefore, cystic fibrosis is not real. Again, it's just an argument you can't use anywhere except in the psychiatric literature or psychological literature when you're trashing DID. It's simply not logically or scientifically true. If disorders accumulate in the practices of subspecialists in those disorders, that's totally non-surprising. Incorrect references are indication of careless research in the skeptical literature. So that's not an error of their thinking, that's an error of their referencing. So when you read these articles by these skeptics, the level of errors in the references is above the norm for literature in general and above the norm for the DID literature, just pure mistakes. And missing references, these guys leave out so many references, so they'll say there's no research on, and they won't cite like the 10 papers of research on that. So the level of scholarship is just pathetic. DID has been created experimentally, which proves it's not valid. Okay. In real medicine, we have a thing called an animal model. Everybody who's studying cancer wants to have an animal model of the cancer. So if you could get some mice to smoke a whole bunch of cigarettes, you could see if they get lung cancer, and then you could try some chemo on them, and you could take a sample of their lung tissue and study it under a microscope and try and figure out how it all works. That's an animal model. Animal models don't prove that the humans don't have the disease. It gives us the opportunity to study the disease in the laboratory. So the animal model, or the experimental model, disproves the disease. Again, nobody says this anywhere else in medicine or psychiatry. Okay, it's possible to create DID in the laboratory, therefore it never occurs in the world. I mean, when you just step back and look at it, it's such preposterous thinking. If it was impossible to create DID in the laboratory, then you might go, it doesn't exist in the world, because human beings can't do that. The human mind doesn't work that way. The human mind doesn't respond to the environment by creating parts. So the argument's totally backwards. No, I kind of got in trouble in the ISSTD when I published my book on the CIA doctors, CIA mind control experiments, where the documents, not the interpretation of the documents or reading between the lines, clearly and explicitly stated straight up, I did these experiments and I created multiple personality and we inserted hypnotic access codes and we used them in operations. So this is 1943 is the first time this was written in print in a book called Hypnotism by G.H. Estabrooks. Last time he stated that in print was 1971 in Science Digest. In between those two time periods, I have copies of extensive correspondence back and forth between him and J. Edgar Hoover spanning decades. I mean, there's this mountainous pile of evidence and many, many, many levels and types of evidence demonstrating that it is possible to get control of somebody and create an alter personality and use that alter personality in missions. It's just a fact. It's not a conspiracy theory, it's not a rumor, it's not an out there thing. So what does that prove? that proves that if you get somebody, you get control over them, you terrorize them and hypnotize them and give them drugs and maybe put them in sensory deprivation and do whatever you need to do, they'll pop an altar. That makes it more likely that kids will do this spontaneously, because that's what the human mind does when it's traumatized in that way. So the experimental case of multiple personality actually validates, it doesn't disprove multiple personality. But what are the experiments that these guys are talking about? They're not talking about the CIA mind control experiments. Not polite to refer to that. They're talking about Nicholas Spanos and other people who've done experiments with college students. So they bring the college student in. So here's the experiment. Here's how I'm going to prove that there's no such thing as having a bad back and needing to be on compensation because you got so much pain you can't work anymore. That's not real, ever. Here's how I'm going to prove it. I'm going to get some college students, and I'm going to give them course credit, and I'm going to give them some vignettes for how people behave when they have chronic lumbar back pain, and then I'm going to get them to act as if they have chronic lumbar back pain, and then that'll prove that nobody really has a bad back. And then after the experiment's over, these college students will just go back and play basketball and behave normally. That proves that there's no such thing as lumbar degenerative disc disease. This is literally what they did. They took people, they brought them in, normal college students, they gave them some scripts to practice having DID, and then they acted as if they have DID. They got course credit, and then they went back to their life and they didn't have DID. This is the experiment. You can get college students to pretend like they have something for course credit. What does that prove? I mean, it's monumentally preposterous. But it gets cited in the literature. It's in all the introductory psychology texts. Get a round of applause, good research. This is like what we're facing. DID must be completely unconscious to be genuine. Well, who in the DID field ever said that? Okay, so when you're working with somebody with DID, the DID is completely unconscious, therefore they don't know they have it, right? Well, if it's completely unconscious and they don't know they have it, how do you know they have it? It doesn't even make any sense. What do you mean totally unconscious? There's somebody's totally unconscious that they're depressed. Somebody's totally unconscious that they have bulimia. Somebody's totally unconscious they have DID. The whole thing doesn't make any sense whatsoever. It's preposterous. Are people sometimes unconscious of their motives and why they do things and they don't take responsibility and they kind of like put it over there and don't think about it? Obviously. So life is a mixture of conscious and unconscious. Also true of DID. Nobody in the DID literature is saying it's totally unconscious. So you set up this straw man, the DID people say it's totally unconscious, and then you go, that's not true, and you've just destroyed DID. This is in kindergarten, not in university. In university, people don't do that. If satanic ritual abuse and alien abductions are not real, neither is DID. Again, repeated in the literature over and over and over. So let's just say it's true that satanic ritual abuse and DID are not real. So, what does that prove? The big majority of people with DID do not describe satanic ritual abuse or alien abduction, so what's it got to do with anything? So again, as an argument, it doesn't even make any sense, even if you agree that those things are not real. Of course, if they are sometimes real, then the whole argument is totally out. The extreme case escalation tactic. That's you're making an argument that all members of the National Football League beat their wives. And you go and find the worst case, which is whoever the worst case is. And that proves that every single player in the NFL is a spousal batterer. Again, like nobody says this. And the data, in fact, are clear that the rates of spousal battery by NFL players are somewhat lower than the general population norms for the same age group and same racial mix of people. That's an established, proven research fact. So what do we see in the introductory psychology textbook? In 2015, in this millennium, not in the previous millennium, we see currently over and over and over and over, We can disprove the reality of DID by talking about the Hillside Strangler case, Kenneth Bianchi, in the 1970s. One case of a guy who faked DID, probably, but not even for sure, but probably, I'll go with probably. So even if we agree that he faked DID to try and get out of being a serial killer and going to jail for the rest of his life, which didn't even work, he's in jail. So even if that was a guy faking it, this is going to tell us something about all this hundreds and thousands of people in treatment today. One case of a guy in the 70s who faked DID. But this is in the psychology text as the big evidence that needs to be reviewed, and a bunch of paragraphs are devoted to it. So arguments are not relevant. Concluding that DID is not, so I covered that. Okay, concluding that DID is spuriously related to trauma without examining the relevant data. So they just say DID has nothing to do with trauma, and they don't look at any of the research studies on the rates of trauma in DID. They don't look at a relatively small number of studies with validated, corroborated trauma histories in DID. They just say, the sky is purple. And everybody's going, well, I never said the sky is purple. It looks blue to me. Sky is purple, DID is not real. That's the way the argument goes. Absolute conclusion, there's no evidence that childhood trauma reported by people with DID actually occurred. So they don't say we need more evidence, which we do. They don't say the research is imperfect. They say there is no evidence of any kind whatsoever. An absolute statement, which is simply not factually true. Changing the psychotherapy, claiming that psychotherapy for DID is typically harmful without reviewing the relevant literature. It's bad, it always damages people. Okay, that could be true. Shooting people in drive-by shootings is generally damaging to the people, right? So you can do things that are pretty well all the time damaging, including possibly DID psychotherapy. So that could be true. How are we going to determine whether it is or isn't true? Maybe we would like to look at the actual treatment outcome literature. So they don't do that. They just say that thinking mean thoughts about other gang members causes them to die. But well, where's the evidence? So they make all these extreme statements, and they don't have any burden for evidence, and they don't even review the evidence that's in the literature. Okay, so I'm going to jump over. I'm only going to take another 5 minutes, and I got to go real quick here. So this is just another example. This guy, Joel Paris, who published this paper saying all these ridiculous things, and we had a chance, several members of the field, to make responses in this journal. But these kind of claims can get published in the psychiatric literature right up until now. They didn't die out 20 years ago. Okay, so this is the concluding case. Get a load of how ridiculous this is. So Shirley Mason is Sybil. She was born in 1923, died in 1998. And here's, so this Debbie Nathan wrote a book, Sybil Exposed, proving that Sybil was just a fake, cooked up by her doctor, Cornelia Wilbur. And here's the proof. In her book, all of this stuff on this slide and the next slide are from her book. And what she's saying is from extensive research and extensive interviews with people in Shirley Mason's hometown. So this is all corroborated evidence from other people, not from Shirley Mason herself, who died before Debbie Nathan wrote the book. So she had 5 sessions with Dr. Wilbur from 8:145 to 12:2645. And up until the last session, she functioned well with no signs of DID, according to Debbie Nathan. The symptoms of DID began after the therapy restarted in 1954, and the DID was caused, which was MPD back then, by that therapy beginning in 1954. That's her thesis. What symptoms were described prior to first contact with Dr. Wilbur in 1945, according to Debbie Nathan? So Debbie Nathan's picture is no DID up until 1954. She gets back into treatment, and the DID is created out of nowhere. no pre-existing symptoms. You'd just be going like, this is not possible. This book couldn't get published by a mainstream publisher. Okay, so here's the symptoms. Fugue states. She would come to somewhere, she didn't know how that she got there, and she didn't know who she was. Blank spells. Spending hours playing with imaginary companions, with all of whom had names, far beyond the age this occurs in non-traumatized children. So like up until after age 10. Pretending to be Vicky, one of her imaginary companions at times. Her mother calling her by the names of alter personalities later identified in adult therapy. Talking in a high childish voice when she was no longer a child. Numerous symptoms consistent with somatoform dissociation, which is psychosomatic kind of symptoms. Going to bars to drink with men and not remembering afterwards, which Debbie Nathan and the people she interviewed did not attribute to the alcohol. Suddenly going comatose in public. Suddenly acting dramatically out of character. This is the person who had no symptoms of DID before 1954. This is all corroborated, not quite conclusive, but obviously highly consistent with DID symptoms described by numerous observers occurring on a chronic basis throughout her childhood, prior to even meeting Dr. Wilbur for the first time. And what's Debbie Nathan's explanation, who is not a physician? Her explanation is these symptoms were all caused by pernicious anemia. Funny thing is, no doctor ever diagnosed or treated her for pernicious anemia. There is no evidence that she had pernicious anemia. It's just made up out of nowhere. And pernicious anemia doesn't cause these symptoms anyway. If the symptoms were caused by untreated pernicious anemia, why did they go into remission from 1945 to 1954? What happened to this pernicious anemia that caused the DID, that must have been causing all these symptoms that existed before 1945? So this pernicious anemia was causing all these symptoms up until 1945, up until I got it. The pernicious anemia that she didn't have was causing all these symptoms up till 1945. Without being diagnosed or treated by anybody, it suddenly went into remission for 9 years. And then at the time she started to see Dr. Wilbur again, the pernicious anemia just cropped up and started causing the DID. It's completely medically impossible. This is her analysis, and then the final nail in the coffin, proving that Shirley Mason didn't really have DID. Oh, by the way, I want to tell you about this complicated case I had. This is a guy who was referred to me by a colleague who'd been treating him for heavy alcohol abuse for many years. And I worked with him and he kept saying, yeah, I've got a heavy drinking problem. And then one day he came in and one time said to me, no, I don't have a drinking problem. And I concluded that in fact he never had a drinking problem, because I know that alcoholics never deny their drinking problems. Is that, you think you want to refer somebody else with a drinking problem to me? They just have to go one time, I don't have a drinking problem, and that locks it down. They don't. This is what happened in this case. In all these years of treatment, in one letter to Cornelia Wilbur, she said once, I don't have DID, and that was it. That proves that in fact she didn't have DID. That's the argument. So it's just monumentally preposterous, unscientific, ridiculous, not true, not possible. So this tells you what we're dealing with. We're not dealing with rational, medical, scientific, professional, university-based arguments. This is big resistance. This is something to do with these people's personal stories. I don't know what it is. It's not coming from intellect. It's not coming from science. And the rules of the game that are set up are fraudulent. It's academic fraud. They're dishonest, they're unacceptable, and they would not be accepted anywhere else in the mental health field or anywhere else in medicine. As we know, I'll explain how I know this. I read the textbook. When I was a resident from 1981 to 1985, I read the Comprehensive Textbook of Psychiatry, third edition, published in 1980. And I learned all the stuff about all these things that I need to know as a psychiatrist. At the back of volume three was a section called Topics of Special Interest, which means like little fluffy stuff you don't really need to bother with, but we'll put it in there anyway. In Topics of Special Interest was a short chapter on incest, which is not really relevant to the general practice of psychiatry. In that short chapter on incest was one paragraph talking about how common incest is, with a reference to a 1955 study saying it's one family out of a million in North America. These were the scientific medical facts when I was in training. It's actually more than one family out of 100. So this is just denial, 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 keeping the secret, keeping a lid on it, posturing as science and medicine and psychiatry. That's all it is. But nevertheless, I like these guys. That's all I've got to say. Thank you for listening. I'm happy to take some questions and feel free to go for a break, except I can't take questions from the front row. Sorry. Why is this happening? I think, so my first answer, it is, you can't, if it wasn't happening, you would say it's impossible. This cannot happen in the university, in the mental health field. Oh, the question is, why is this happening, this level of resistance? How is it possible? Because if it wasn't happening, you would think it's just impossible. Academic standards at universities won't allow this. You can't publish this stuff. So first explanation is, I don't know. But I think it's multiple factors. One factor is just horrible standards of scholarship in psychiatry across the board in general, no matter what the subject. Another is, for whatever set of reasons, there's been a massive campaign to suppress the relevance of childhood trauma in psychiatry, which is still ongoing today. And the motives for that would include a bunch of who knows what. It would include a bunch of people who are themselves victims who don't want it talked about, don't want it dealt with, don't want to recognize how it's affecting them, and don't want to deal with it in their patients because then they'll get triggered. Then it's a bunch of perpetrators in the profession who want it all shut down and aren't taking responsibility for the effect of their behavior on everybody around them, including their own children. Then there's some sort of theories of how memory works ideas, so it's kind of like intellectual paradigm shift type thing. There's just professional shame. If it is true that DID affects about 4% of general adult psychiatric inpatients, so one out of every 25 people coming into a psych hospital in the United States has undiagnosed DID, and all these psychiatrists are not making that diagnosis, that's clear evidence that they're incompetent, and it's shameful, and it's embarrassing. So the solution is it's not real. We're not missing it. Yeah, it exactly mirrors the way the Catholic Church responded to priest abuse. By the way, when the Catholic Church set up a committee to advise them on the problem of clergy abuse, they only appointed one psychiatrist, who is the leading psychiatrist of the False Memory Syndrome Foundation, Paul McHugh. So that tells you where they're coming from. It's all the Puritans' fault. She's got the answer. Right, so she went into the hospital a few months ago and ran into this brick wall big time, which happens very often.
And I mean, they were writing that I was having hallucinations instead of shifting, I mean, all kinds of experiences. So clearly the hospital was not the problem. But I guess the question for me is when situations like that happen and I have to take care of my
right.
Safety, how can, I don't have a choice, there's the hospital.
That's right.
Where I go. Worse than I went in, which is not ideal.
Well, so what to do when you have DID and you go into a non-believing hospital equals most of the hospitals in the United States, which vary from just ignore it to actively hostile attack you about it. Number one, I don't have the answer. I really, really do not have the answer. But I would say just keep your head low and try and get whatever timeout stabilization and get out of there as soon as you can. I don't think there's anything else to do. If we go back a few slides here. Ross, CA, 1990. I've been publishing this analysis in increasing detail for 25 years, and it's had, just my personal effort has had no impact on these people. The impact of the field, all the publications, ISSCD, the research, including lots of American Journal of Psychiatry papers, hasn't affected these guys at all. So the odds that you're going to be able to debate them out of their mindset is zero. So I just say, duck your head and survive. I'm not aware of any cases either currently in the works or successfully prosecuted for malpractice for failing to diagnose DID. I'm not aware there's ever been one. Well, I'm not sure like the legal definition of fraud, and so it's not illegal to say stupid stuff that isn't true at universities. So I just don't know the legal definitions and how you would frame the case and who would be the plaintiff. And how would you establish that this guy at this university saying this dumb stuff personally damaged this class of individuals? So it's pretty murky legally, so just trying to get a lawyer to take it on and spend all that money on spec, it's a huge hurdle. Say a little louder, sorry. You would think that it would be easy to have successful cases. And so the two questions are why the legal system hasn't taken them on and why the profession hasn't clambered for them. A profession doesn't want to hear about these cases, right? So my only answer is, yeah, you would think it would be possible to design a very clear-cut case and prove it. I don't know why that hasn't happened. Because like all the interviews, the standardized interviews, the questionnaires, the things to ask, the research literature, how common it is, that's all there for the expert witness to point to. And interviewing people and establishing, like many, you'd have to have a case where there's family members who knew the person beforehand who can say, yeah, I knew their alters by name, and you have somebody where the sister corroborates the abuse history. You could have a very locked down case, which is not that hard to find, which would be absolutely winnable, you would think. So half of my answers are, I don't know. Yeah, I've actually written about that in several different places. So repression is a Freudian term. And there's primal repression and repression proper. So there's even two subtypes of repression in Freudian theory. And one is, so you have to have a little diagram. There's a horizontal barrier in your mind, horizontal repression barrier, or vertical barrier. So in Freudian repression theory, there's two forms of repression. There's these id impulses, things in your unconscious mind that are threatening to come up into your unconscious, and you repress them back down before you even become conscious of them. So that has nothing to do with events in the outside world or memories or anything. Then the other form of repression is information comes into your mind, it's in your ego, your conscious mind, your ego is all upset about it, and your ego pushes it down into the unconscious. So the memories are stored in the unconscious mind where they're subject to primary process that all the way the unconscious mind works. And then they get all distorted and dreams get mixed in and fantasies, and then they come back up and you can't tell what's real and what's not. That's Freudian repression. Dissociation is a vertical barrier. In dissociation theory, the material is not pushed down to some buried unconscious, it's shifted over to another compartment in the conscious mind. So just as a theoretical defense mechanism, it's a completely different thing. And then we go to, there's no measures of, the definition of dissociation is that defense mechanism definition. But the research definition of dissociation is it's all the symptoms in measures of dissociation that are in the DSM, that we have statistics for, and so on. There's no statistics or measures for repression at all. It's like a totally separate thing. Then dissociation is a general term in general systems theory. It just is another word for disconnecting. It's instead of being associated, connected, interacting, you're dissociated. And there's dissociation constants in physical chemistry. It's a technical term in cognitive psychology. And so dissociation is a very rigorously proven thing in psychology with thousands of experiments. And there's no experimental proof of repression at all. And then, so there's all these different meanings of the word dissociation, which are all different from the meaning of repression. That's a quick capsule summary. So I think we have 10 minutes. Anybody with? I shouldn't have looked over here. The whole thing's totally sociological and political and cultural, totally. But the medical sector, by and large, doesn't like this subsection of the DSM. They're concerned about suing people for diagnosing it, but not suing people for failing to diagnose it. Okay. As this woman over here was. Oh yeah, that's the hysteria that goes on. We're going to get sued. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. But the frequency of false memory lawsuits is so tiny now, it's just a bogus fear.
Well, that's because they're probably winning.
No, it's because they're not winning anymore. For several reasons. One is there's a huge wave of these false memory lawsuits in the early to mid-90s. And then several things happened. The insurance companies hired managed care companies who clamped down on inpatient stays down to like 7 days average. So the inpatient stays were no longer long enough to cause enough damages to support a lawsuit. So managed care is actually the main force that shut down these lawsuits. The second force was that the defense attorneys who started getting up to speed on how to defend these cases and what expert witnesses and what arguments and how to counter-argue and started successfully defending people. And then it's like any fad in the media. It just gets a bunch of media attention and then the everybody gets bored. And so it just had its natural little day in the sun and faded out. And then the other thing was, like in the state of Texas where I practice, there's caps on malpractice lawsuits. You can only get a maximum of $250,000. So therefore, to mount a very complicated, long case with lots of depositions, lots of discovery, a long trial, the lawyer's going to recover 40% of the maximum 250, which is 100, but he's going to spend 120, or he's going to risk 70 or 80. So then the financial risk for the plaintiff's lawyer has just disappeared. So there's a bunch of forces. And plus, I think the field got a wake-up call, and the therapists started tightening up their practices so that their boundaries are better and they weren't making themselves susceptible to lawsuits, and I'm going to get sued if I don't be quiet. We have to pull down the walls now for the next session, so thanks for staying a little over.
I'm 6 feet down, but I'm okay. It's just the